Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Drostan Hall, and I am the music director of Camerata Chicago, and I will be your host for this evening. A very warm welcome to you all, and a special welcome to all those watching from home for Camerata Chicago's fourth live stream presentation concert featuring the Academy Chamber Orchestras. I would like to thank Thomas Zolls and Jeremy Whetstone here at PianoForte Chicago Studio for making this superb concert space available to us. And if you're in the market for a piano, I hear that the pianos here are second to none. All of Camerata Chicago's projects and concerts require considerable resources. And on behalf of Camerata Chicago's president, Spencer Garrett, and the board of directors, I would like to thank all our sponsors and donors for making everything possible we do. I would particularly like to thank our principal sponsors, Nick and Tatiana Nenadovich, Joyce Saxon, the Tyndale Foundation, and Jamie and Debbie Fellows. Founded in 2003, Camerata Chicago is a world-class chamber orchestra serving Chicago and its surrounding communities with performances of great music featuring musicians of global distinction. Camerata Chicago is committed to providing an incomparable concert experience which enriches the community and inspires the next generation of musicians and concert goers. The Camerata Chicago Academy was founded in 2014 and since then has grown to two chamber orchestras comprising young, accomplished string players who are serious about music. Each orchestra rehearses once a week under the guidance of a faculty drawn from its professional parent, Camerata Chicago. The rehearsal process includes string quartet and sectional experience as well as the full tutti rehearsals. Now we begin our concert this evening with the Junior Academy, you see here before you, and our first selection is the famous Canon by the 17th century German composer Johann Pachelbel. Now this piece begins with a simple quarter note figure which rapidly develops into smaller and smaller subdivisions of time values up to the 32nd note, and is canonized every two bars by three separate voices, although they are all playing the same music over what we call a ground bass. So the bass and the celli, they play the same two bars over and over again. It never varies. But you hear this florid, wonderful music developing over the top of it. It's quite miraculous, actually, how it is conceived. Now, most of you will recognize this piece as it's often used as a bridal processional. Anyway, here we have it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Our second piece is the Rondeau by the Baroque French composer Jean-Joseph Mauret. Any of you who have enjoyed the show Masterpiece Theatre will recognize this piece as their signature tune. Thank you. The Pavane is a short work by the French composer Gabriel Fauré, written in 1887. It was originally a piano piece, but is better known in Fauré's version for orchestra and optional chorus. It was first performed in Paris in 1888, becoming one of the composer's most popular works.
Thank you. Thank you.
Our final selection, the arrival of the Queen of Sheba, originally for two oboes and strings by George Frederick Handel, premiered in London in 1749 as the first scene of the Act III in the Oratorio Solomon. One of the last of Handel's many oratorios, Solomon is rarely performed in its entirety, but Handel's bright and lively The Arrival of the Queen of Sheba is widely appreciated and very often used as a processional set piece. In fact, a noted public performance of the piece occurred during the opening ceremonies of the London 2012 Olympic Games. So here it is. Intermission while we move from the Junior Academy to the Senior Academy. Senior Academy, please come to the stage. Thank you very much. And Junior Academy, thank you. And now we come to the Senior Academy, and our first piece, the story of the first piece that we're going to play of Rossini is The Barber of Seville. It was written in 1816, and just the premiere would have made a great comedy in and of itself. At 24, Rossini was already an opera veteran and accepted the commission to deliver The Barber of Seville within 5 weeks. First, his impresario died, but the show had to go on to provide for his widow and children. Second, the regular audience totally were against the idea because they liked Paisiello's version much better. Well, so they thought at the time. They'd never heard Rossini's yet, but they're against it. It's new. Third, at the world premiere, a singer fell on his face while coming on to stage and had to sing his opening number through a large nosebleed. Fourth, a cat got on stage and terrorized the cast with its claws. Fifth, and finally, the tenor decided to stop the show and add a few numbers of Spanish guitar songs to his scene. By now, the house was in total uproar, and any chance of a fair hearing was long gone. Rossini left at the interval, claiming to be ill. He did not attend the second night, which actually was a shame because it was a whole different affair. People listened, and what they heard, they loved. Well-wishers ran to his house and roused him from his sick bed and to bring him to the house to acknowledge the triumph. Here we have the overture. Thank you. We now have a little bit of stage management, so bear with us for 2 minutes. Thank you. Giuseppe Antonio Capuzzi was born in 1755 and died in 1818. He was an Italian violinist and composer. Similar to Vivaldi, he studied in Venice, Italy. Although popular in his day, most of his music is now forgotten. The most commonly performed piece today is, in fact, this concerto for double bass. The concerto was found in the British Museum, as all the best things are, that's good, and was dedicated to Cavalier Mark Antonio Montenegro, who is assumed to have performed on that instrument. The second and third movements of the concerto have been poached by the tuba, the euphonium, and the trombone. Tonight we hear it played on a double bass by Lawrence Hall in an arrangement for strings without the oboes and horns. Here we have it.
Thank you.
Composer of the cadenza is in the audience as well, Aaron Policastro. He's here. Yeah. We will now proceed with our next piece. So, senior academy members, please step onto the stage. Thank you. Thank you for your patience. One of the single most difficult thing to do for a string player is to play in tune. So it helps to start with the instrument in tune. So thank you for your patience. According to legend, death appears at midnight every year on Halloween. Death calls forth the dead from their graves to dance for him while he plays his fiddle. Here represented by a solo violin, his skeletons dance for him until the rooster crows at dawn, when they must return to their graves until the next year. The solo violin enters playing a tritone, which is an interval which is known as diabolus in musica during the medieval and baroque era. So it has a, you know, sort of a nasty sound, you know, that sound. And in fact, Amelia, would you please help us there to show us what it's going to sound like? All right, so that's the Diabolus in Musica. Now, there is also a direct quote of the Dies Irae, which is the hymn of the dead from the Requiem Mass. Here, you'll hear Kate on the piano play it. Thank you. And strangely, he writes it in this particular context in a major key, which gives it a slightly kind of weird, happy sound as well. Then, at the end, you will hear the cock crowing, played by the oboe in the original orchestration, but here played by the solo violin, and it represents the dawn breaking and the skeletons returning to their graves. Amelia. Okay, so let's say that tonight's performance is dedicated to the death, demise, and dismissal of COVID-19.
Well done. Thank you. Thank you.
All right, well, thank you very much indeed for coming. It is wonderful to play for a live audience again. And I wish for many more, and it's just a wonderful feeling. So thank you again for coming, and all at home in your comfortable armchairs, thank you for tuning in. Oh, yeah, I do have some other remarks. So thank you to all of the Academy musicians, junior and senior. Another round of applause. And I would say they gave us passionate music making this evening. Thank you again to Thomas Zolls and for Jeremy Whetstone here at PianoForte Chicago and for allowing us to use their wonderful space here. Please do visit our website, cameratachicago.org, to learn more about our activities and upcoming concerts. I would like to leave you with this quote. The aim and final end of all music should be none other than the glory of God and the refreshment of the soul. Johann Sebastian Bach. With that, I bid you all a good night. Thank you.